Hello, and following last week's video report on great optical solutions seen during the last EPHG trade fair, well, we are continuing along that line with some other exhibitors seen there with some pretty interesting stuff. First of all, we come back on a company which specializes in refurbishing old school machines, and not because they look cool, but simply because they were originally greatly built and still do the job really well. Materials used at the time were of great quality, and it's difficult today to find such equivalent. We'll then talk about the evolution of robots and how they are now developed to interact with humans, and finally, we'll go back on some other optical solutions used for quality control, but with the main difference that these solutions are used on much greater scale jobs by helping control full lines of products very efficiently. So yes, yet another techie report.
Alors en fait, ce genre de machine manuelle, il n'y a plus beaucoup de fabricants qui existent. On va dire la majeure partie de ces fabricants ont fait faillite dans les années 80 voire 90. Et donc c'est des machines de qualité, raison pour laquelle on les refait. On va dire maintenant notre concurrence pour ce type de machine manuelle, c'est plutôt des machines asiatiques, mais qui n'ont pas du tout les mêmes qualités géométriques de précision. Voilà. Donc on les remet à neuf tout simplement parce qu'elles sont précises, elles sont durables, elles sont solides. Il y a une chose qui est intéressante dans notre métier, c'est qu'on travaille comme il y a 30-40 ans en arrière au niveau mécanique. Si vous connaissez peut-être le grattage c'est ce qui consiste à remettre en état géométrique la machine. C'est un travail manuel qui est très physique pour lequel on obtient une meilleure précision qu'une machine le ferait. Et les clients nous envoient leurs machines à réviser, à remettre à neuf ou à moderniser, ou alors nous on vend des machines révisées qu'on va aller chercher dans le monde entier. Alors il y en a beaucoup en Suisse, il y en a beaucoup en Europe, mais il nous est arrivé par exemple d'aller en chercher en Inde, des machines un petit peu spécifiques, mais de la machine suisse en fait. On refait toutes les parties électriques, donc les parties électriques c'est-à-dire des composants on va dire actuel, des variateurs de fréquence, on fait un petit peu d'automation, on numérise, enfin on automatise un petit peu également les machines, et on va dire tout ce qui est composants mécaniques, ça n'a pas varié, enfin ça n'a pas évolué. La fonte, c'est ce qui fait la qualité de ces machines. Les bâtis, les coulisses, tout est en fonte, et les fontes, quand elles vieillissent, elles se stabilisent. D'où une précision importante et une stabilité des machines. Alors, il n'y a pas d'équivalent en neuf, en fait. Donc, les machines neuves, c'est plutôt des machines d'usinage, de production. Nous, on va dire, c'est de la machine de retouche, c'est de la machine de prototypage. Et comme je vous disais, il n'y a que des machines asiatiques qui nous concurrencent, mais qui sont de piètre qualité.
OK, so let's now talk about robots and the evolution of their interactive dimension with human operators, as we saw something introduced by ABB with a robot where it's no longer a danger to stand next to it and even directly interact with it. As you can imagine, robots are widely used in watchmaking, especially for mass-produced, industrialized type of watches. The goal naturally being the search of improved general efficiency within the manufacturing process, i.e. reducing the human cost on one side, but also, and in all fairness, guaranteeing the level of quality on some repetitive task. Okay, I know that on the Watches TV we talk more about timepieces that are mainly manually crafted and assembled, but this is also a reality of the watchmaking industry that I would quickly like to address. CNC machines can naturally be considered as robots too, and they have been used since already quite a long time, and even super high-end brands use them to machine cases and other components, among other things. It's normal, and there are no reason why such solutions shouldn't be used, and actually I even think it deserves a dedicated video report. But the robot we got to see concerns more those kind of repetitive actions seen on the production line, such as taking an object and placing it from point A to point B. Obviously the robot will have a runtime close to 24/7 with a super marginal error rate. But what is interesting here is that it showcases a bit more about the increased presence of robots in our daily lives and the impact it has. As you can see, this robot almost has this something friendly to it when it comes to its design, with these kind of chubby arms, and the coating is not a cold metallic one, but it has some kind of neoprene coating which makes it feel a bit warmer when you touch it. In a certain way, it's less scary, especially if you compare it, for instance, with these huge robotic production lines you see in the automotive industry, with these machines, these massive machines standing in football stadium-sized facilities. I just saw the other day on TV an example of this with a car plant in the UK building minis, and you would be seriously scared and impressed to walk between all these gigantic machines. There's this kind of Transformers Matrix feeling to it, something not inviting at at all, but damn efficient if you consider that this huge facility was controlled only by a bunch of guys, when the same level of work was probably achieved by thousands of workers a few decades ago only. It's a bit like these massive 250 meter long cargo ships transporting 15,000 containers at the same time, with only a crew of 20 people because most of the handling is now done by computers and robots. Humans being there are there mainly to supervise that all is running well, and that's about it. And this is something we also see with what we call industrial watchmaking. And again, I don't have much of a problem with it, as long as things are transparent or, well, at the very minimum, not misleading in making you believe, for instance, that there is this kind of little watchmaker doing everything by hand in his little atelier. Anyhow, and coming back on the subject, what I found interesting is really the fact that with these new robots, it's as if there was a will of integrating them better in our daily environment, that the frontier between robots and us is getting thinner. With this robot presented by ABB and seen at the APG, you can really stand next to it, you can grab it as it is performing its task without having your arm being torn away. It will immediately sense your presence and stop within a microsecond if you do so. This means that this robot can stand next to you and not within some kind of cage and protected environment, and therefore really becomes your working buddy, so to say. Okay, there are many tasks that this robot can do which aren't necessarily so gratifying for humans. Like I mentioned, I don't see much of added value if a human operator is taking part XYZ and placing it from point A to point B, and doing so repetitively during 8 hours a day and every single day of the week. But nevertheless, it is yet another sign of our evolving societies and the deep transformation technology is bringing to us. As you know, I admire traditional watchmaking. This is art with a capital A, no doubt in my mind, but where do you place the cursor when it comes of adapting your production processes for much more regular lines of watches? I believe this is still an open question, or to be more precise, something that not that many people want to talk about when we're talking high-end watchmaking, but it's for sure already a reality, especially when such robots are now more and more kind of affordable for the level of technology involved. I mean, in this featured example, the cost of a complete machine like this one is approximately $75,000. So when you put in parallel the cost of human labor, I can see why some executives are scratching their heads about implementing these solutions. But does it mean that your watch will cost less? Well, that is a totally different question, unfortunately. Okay, let's now change subject, but still with an angle regarding automation, and this time on the quality control process using optical solution to assess what comes out of a watchmaking production line. And to do so, we went to meet people from Fujifilm, and they explained to us how their technology is functioning and what it brings on the table.
So imagine you have a production line and you have a problem there. Something is jamming or not working properly. So the speeds these production lines have, sometimes it's just impossible for us to see with our eyes what is happening. So we put aside a system that records for a long time, just records. We have some device with SSD, a hard disk, for example. And then you can also combine it with some trigger signal. That means the machine can also send out a trigger signal to the camera when the jam is happening. Or you can just go through the timeline and check, okay, the jam happened 10, 25, and 38 seconds. So you go back and you can then precisely analyze what happens. What is the problem of the machine? And you can solve the problem more easily than normally when you do just try and error and you have perhaps an experienced production guy that tries and knows, okay, it could be that or this, but it takes much more time. And so it's much more easy to do it with a high speed system aside. We have also newly now, and this is a great solution, 3D here, you see, you can even do inline inspection with 3D. That means you can, for example, check the height of the product at a precision of much below 1 micron to ensure that the tolerances are respected. When we go back to a 2D camera like that one, we see a strong move in CMOS technology. So that means higher sensitivity, higher speed, lower cost. And so this is taking place now already. So that means the watchmaker could even speed up his production line, which is not possible today. So this evolution will go on. because there is a much R&D in that area. And as you know, Sony has announced that CCD production will be stopped soon. So this is now given some new opportunities, and of course also regarding the pricing and everything, it's getting much more attractive to use that kind of camera to inspect also lower cost products. And the idea is you have the same resolution as with a smaller camera, but you can inspect at the same time a much larger field of view. So this is also a tendency we see, and for that you also need appropriate lenses that have a high resolution and can catch a big, large field of view to speed up also things. So that's another trend, and of course there is also a need for very good lenses, and we see here for example a new 4K that can catch these large fields of view at the same resolution they do today, but only with a fourth of the size of the field of view, for example.
So that's it for some of our interesting stuff we got to see at the EPHG, and there were naturally plenty of other cool techie stuff seen there, but this will be for next year's coverage of this trade fair. So all the best to you, and thanks again for watching and commenting, of course. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel if not yet done. See you real soon, and so long till then.